A very good morning to all of you. Thank you very much, Mr. Rector, for inviting me to come to Kazan for the first time. It is indeed a great honor, and already between yesterday and this morning, visiting some of your prestigious institutes and the museum, and today being in this very historical assembly hall, I feel humbled because I realize that I did not know a lot about your university that has a very glorious past and that has today so many prestigious scientists, so many very intelligent students. So it is indeed an honor and a privilege to stand in front of you this morning. Mr. Rector asked me to introduce myself. I don't like to say many things about me. I just want to say that I come from Morocco. I studied in France, in the US, and in the UK. And to this day, I still consider myself to be a student of universities. And I'm grateful for this opportunity to learn about your distinguished university. And perhaps what I'm most proud of in my career is not only the work, the scholarly work that I have done as an education economist, but also being the proud father of three children. And maybe I can mention that my oldest son, who released yesterday his first video game, it's called Ellipsis, so I'm very proud about that. But yesterday, when I started to learn about everything that this university is doing, I must confess that I became very nervous because I asked myself, what could I teach you or tell you about that you don't already know? And I realized that I needed some help in preparing my speech. So last night, I walked into the streets of Kazan to seek some help. And luckily, I found this charming lady who offered to tell me about my future. And I thanked her. I said, you know, my future is already behind me. I am more interested about the future of higher education. So she was very helpful and she gave me her insights about the future of higher education. So I wrote it down on my iPad and I'm gonna share with you what she said. In the future, it will be compulsory to go to university for all youth, all young people from a country. And to attract your students, you will need to have a more marketable name for your university. So, for example, you could call it the University of Lovely Professionals. And to recruit your students in the future, you will do that mainly on Facebook. In the future, when you get new students, you will give them an iPad or a Kindle with all the textbooks for the duration of their studies. And in countries where there is not much interest to study science or engineering, universities will go already to the kindergarten to explain and motivate young children about the importance of science or engineering. In the future, if a student needs financial support, she or he will participate in an auction on eBay to get a scholarship or a student loan. In the future, elite university will have no more than 10 students. And mass university will have 300,000 students online from all over the world. Because gaming and simulations are increasingly important, universities will have a professor of Lego to teach about games. In the future, we will not use emails anymore because it's too slow. We will communicate through WhatsApp and this kind of social media to do it much quicker. In the future, students will take open internet exams. That means they will have access to the internet during their exams. In the future, the standard duration of a lecture will be only 5 minutes. And most lectures will be online. And that has bad news for the professors here, because you will have the degrees that you will give will be have a validity of only 5 years. So it means that the courses that you give will have to be redesigned every 3 years. And in fact, in the future, the salaries of the professor will be based on the evaluation of your students. We will have, it will be much cheaper in the future to build a university or lab, because we will have e-library and iLabs, all virtual. Also, in the future, you will grade the papers and the exam of the students using a software that will be based on artificial intelligence. In the future, the board of the university will be made mainly of 18-year-old students, because they will know better about the needs of the university. If your graduates do not find a proper job 6 months after leaving the universities, you will have to reimburse them the cost of their studies. And bad news for public university like Kazan University, because in the future, you will get only 10% of your budget from the government. But don't worry, because you will be so successful in getting money from the outside world that half year, after 6 months in the academic year, you will tell the philanthropist out there, it's enough money for this year. Come back next year with your money. Good news for the rector, because in the future, the salary of the annual salary of the rector will be $1 million, the equivalent of $1 million. But it will be indexed on the ranking of the university, going up or down with the ranking. In countries where English is not the mother tongue, parents will have surgery performed of their young children to cut the little skin that ties the tongue to the mouth to improve their English language pronunciation. And those of you who think that the MBA is a good degree, forget about it, because in the future, the best degree will be the MFA, Master in Fine Arts, because creativity and design will be so important. Now, you may think that I'm telling you science fiction stories about the future, right? I can assure you, each example that I have just mentioned is not from the future. It's something I have seen as I travel around the world. And I believe that it is symbolic of the revolution that the world of higher education is going through. And so the challenge for you is to ask yourself, is Kazan Federal University ready to participate in this revolution? And to answer this question with you this morning, I have divided my presentation into two parts. First, I want to remind ourselves about the importance of knowledge for innovation, and then look at how innovation is impacting higher education. So let me start with the first part, the importance of knowledge. You may have recognized the Prime Minister of Norway. She just started last year, and in one of her first speeches, she told people in her country that they should forget about oil. Norway, like Kazan, has great oil resources. But she said that the future of Norway is not oil, it is knowledge. Knowledge is the oil of the future. And to illustrate the importance of knowledge, I would like to share some studies that my former colleagues at the World Bank, where I worked for 25 years as coordinator for higher education, did, comparing two countries, South Korea and Brazil, over the year. Now, it's very interesting. If you look at what happened at the beginning of the 60s, both countries, Korea and Brazil, were at the same level of economic development. But over time, they went different paths. And today we see Korea up there and Brazil down there. Now, this is counterintuitive because Korea is a poor country. 70% of Korea is only mountains. They have very little natural resources. And Brazil is a huge country with lots of resources. And so my colleagues at the World Bank, when they try to understand why is Korea having much better results than Brazil, they realized that most of the success of Korea can be attributed to the fact that much better than Brazil, they have been able to apply new knowledge and new technologies. So I'm going to make a test with you today to try to see whether what I'm saying is maybe true. By any chance, does anyone here drive either a Hyundai or a Kia car? Yes, no, nobody? Okay, we have a few. By any chance, does anyone today in his or her pocket or handbag have a Samsung cellular phone? Yes, show of hands. Many of you, right? By any chance, does anyone at home watch the news on an LG TV screen? Quite a few. By any chance, do you have a high technology Brazilian product that you use every day? No? Unless you are the owner of an Embraer airplane, right? Now, it's interesting also to look at what happened in education in both countries. On this graph, I am showing you the proportion of the adult population with their level of education. On the left, we have Korea. On the right, we have Brazil. Red means only primary education, blue is secondary education, and green is higher education. Now, if we look at the graph, in 1960, both countries have the same structure. Most adults have only primary education. But if we fast forward to the future, 2010, look at Korea, how it has changed. At least half of the people have secondary education and 40% have a high education qualifications. Whereas Brazil, which has improved, we still have half of the population with only primary and 40% with only secondary and very little with tertiary education. Another significant data, piece of information about both countries. If we look at what happens when people with a doctorate finish university, in the case of Brazil, most of them stay in the university sector. In the case of Korea, 60% of them go and work in industry in the R&D department, and that explains why they have been so innovative. And if we look at patents, here we have the statistics for patents registered with the US Bureau of Patents. You can see again that in the 80s, annual production of patents is about the same in both countries, 50 for Korea, 39 for Brazil, not a big difference. But if we move forward, today, Korea every year, 14,400, Brazil only 300, less than 400. And remember, as I mentioned earlier, that Korea has only 50 million people, and Brazil has four times as many people. Now, I mentioned Embraer, because this is a very interesting exception. Today, Brazil is the world leader in the production of regional airplanes. And we may ask ourselves, what happened there? Did they just get lucky? Or did something else happen? Indeed, in the late 50s, the government of Brazil decided to set up an aeronautic technology institute in partnership with MIT. And this is how they trained the engineers, the technicians, the scientists who were able to design these world-class airplanes. Now let's move closer to your country, your neighbor Finland, 500 kilometers north of the capital city Helsinki. There is a small town called Oulu in the middle of the forest, and back in the 70s, the main company in Oulu, what did they do? They cut the trees to make paper and cardboard. But then the president of that company got worried about the future of his industry. So he challenged the national government. He said, if you establish a technology university in Oulu, I will invest in new labs and attract private sector investors. Now I tell you, the professors in Helsinki were not very enthusiastic about the idea of moving to this city in the middle of nowhere. But the government said, yes, this is a good idea. And they did establish the University of Oulu. And today, if you look at Google, you will see that the city of Oulu and the university share the same website, because their development has been very closely interlinked. Now, what is the name of this company whose president had this vision towards the future? Maybe some of you heard about them. They are called Nokia. And they went on to become first producing paper, then cables, rubber, to become a world leader in electronics. And when they were doing very well, they contributed 20% of Finland's exports, and they finance two-thirds of R&D funding. Now, some of you may challenge me and say, Professor, this is a very bad example, because we all know that Nokia is not doing too well today. But there is a second lesson there. See, being a leader today doesn't guarantee in any way that I will still be a leader tomorrow. I need to keep investing. I need to keep innovating to stay as a leader. And I believe that this lesson applies also to universities. Being a great university today doesn't guarantee that I will continue being a great university tomorrow if I am complacent. So I have to keep innovating. And that's why I'm so excited to see how innovative your university has been. And another good example of this lesson is what happened to BlackBerry. Did any one of you have a BlackBerry at some time? I had one, but I don't have one anymore, right? What happened with BlackBerry? They started in 1998 as a very small company. In fact, they have just one office on top of a bakery store. And then they were tremendously successful. By 2004, they had 3 million clients, 20,000 employees, $2 billion income in 2006. And then it started to go downhill. Somebody sued them about a small patent. And instead of settling the suit to say, okay, yes, you are right, I'll give you $1 million to... No, they were stubborn. So they had a long legal fight, and they lost, and they had to pay $600 million. And then the two founders of the company did not agree anymore. So they fought, and one of them left. And then something small happened. A company invented another type of phone called the iPhone. And the BlackBerry people, because they were very proud of their keyboard, they dismissed. They say, who will ever be willing to type on a virtual keyboard? No, that will not happen. Well, we know what happened. So forget about BlackBerry. The last point I want to make is about the acceleration in the speed of creation of new knowledge. And here are some statistics to demonstrate that. The first year where we know how many scientific articles were published in the world is 1726. That year, 344 articles were published. And now we can see a very rapid acceleration. By 1800, we had 3,000 articles, 10 times more. By 1900, 60,000. By 2000, more than 1 million. The last year for which I have statistics, already 1.5 million. And I ask you, who can keep up with so many advances in your discipline? And if we, the professors, cannot keep up, how can we expect our students to keep up? Another example to illustrate this rapid transformation. Do you see this big thing here? Can anybody guess what it is? It's the first hard drive. It's very light. It weighs only 1,000 kilos. This is a picture from 1956. And it's so powerful that you could store up to 128 kilobytes of information. So we have to be very grateful now where we can use our USB drive, where we can put up to 2 terabytes of information. But the question for us as professors, how can we keep up? How can we train our students in a world where when they sometimes something that we will teach them in first year of university, by the time they graduate, will have become obsolete. So let me turn now to the second part. How can we use innovation to transform our university education? And I can see three dimensions of innovation. First of all, we have to recognize that the skills and the competencies that our graduates need have changed and are changing. So how do we change the curriculum? Second, we need a new pedagogical approach. And third, we can rely on new technologies to transform both the curriculum and the pedagogy. I'm sure that many of you are aware of the work of Professor Howard Gardner from Harvard, who challenged our way of looking about intelligence. You know, traditionally, we would measure with the IQ, linguistic and mathematical intelligence. That's how we were judging our students and their capabilities. But Howard Gardner challenged us by telling us we have multiple intelligence, what he calls spatial, and our, the way we relate to geography, to the space, bodily intelligence, and artistic intelligence, plus what we would describe as emotional intelligence, how we behave and how we relate to each other. And he claimed that it is very important to develop also these parts of our intelligence. This is why today we have to recognize the importance of generic complex competencies. When I go to a new country, I like to visit companies and to ask them, how do you view the universities? Are they producing the right graduates? And I tell you, everywhere I get, I receive the same answer. They tell me, yes, this university here in this town, it's very good. It prepares good professionals. They know a lot about medicine or engineering, about law, about chemistry. But you know what? They cannot work. They don't know how to work. Why? Because we need other competencies that make a good worker. For example, information analysis, critical thinking, and problem solving. You know, today with the internet, we have every information everywhere. But do we know how to use this information? Do we know which information is right or not valid? Do we know which information we can use to resolve concrete problems? And then we need to the ability to do what is called global contextual analysis. Because I ask you, the students whom you are training, do you want them to be able to work only in Kazan? Or in the Tatar Republic? Or in the Russian Federation? Or in the entire world? Today our world is global. Are we preparing people who are creative to invent new things? Are we preparing people to work with other people? So, from the time I enter kindergarten, and then I go to primary school, secondary school, university, I take exams as an individual. The university today is judging how I fare, what results I have as an individual. But from the time I leave the university, do I work as an individual or do I work as a team member? Think about your work every day. It is a work of collaboration. Even the medical doctor works in a team. So am I training my students to work in teams? And communication. Employers tell me, these people are good professionals, but they don't know how to communicate, how to explain, how to convince, how to persuade. And in fact, when I try to look at scientific studies to describe that, I could not find them. But here is what our cousins, the dolphins, say about our ability to communicate. Although humans make sounds with their mouth and occasionally look at each other, there is no solid evidence that they actually communicate among themselves. And if we look at the news every night on the TV, what do we see? We see images of war, we see images of poverty, of violence, that show that really, as human beings, we're not very good at communicating peacefully among each other. But in addition to these competencies, generic complex competencies, we also need to train our students for what are called character qualities, which are also very important. Neuroscience tells us that to learn well, what is important is not only our intrinsic intelligence, but also our curiosity, the motivation. Earlier, when I visited the museum next door, I was told about the experience of one of your prestigious students, Tolstoy, a genius of literature, but he didn't seem to be very interested in studying properly, right? He was more interested about other things. Neuroscience tells us that to be a good student, we have to be motivated about what we study. We need to develop initiative so that your students and graduates have entrepreneurial thinking. We need to have students who have persistence. Even if they fail, even if they fall, they must be able to get up and say, okay, I made a mistake, but I will do better next time. So it's not only about telling our children, oh, you are very intelligent. No, we have to develop in them the feeling of persistence. Even if they're not doing too well, you have to tell them, instead of telling them, oh, you are stupid, you will never study well. No, you have to tell them, you can do it, you can learn, to encourage them so that they will persist. Our world is changing very fast. We need to adapt and prepare students to adapt. We need to develop leadership skills. And perhaps most importantly, ethical awareness about the social, cultural, environmental dimensions of our world, so that we realize that it is not only about being a competent engineer, but an engineer with a conscience who will contribute to improving our society. So I was telling you about creativity. A friend of mine who is a professor at the University of Hong Kong went to interview the president of Samsung Cellular Phones, asking him the kind of question I told you about, asking him what kind of engineers and technicians do you like to recruit. And the president, to my friend's surprise, the president of Samsung Cellular told him, you know, my problem is not to have good engineers or technicians. My challenge is to find people who are creative, who can, because today, when you think about new products, it's not only about the technical specificities, it's also about design. This is, if you think about it, when you compare different products, Their technical characteristics are pretty much the same. But what makes a difference is how cool they looked. What kind of design? This is why you could go out now and buy a Prada cellular phone. Or you could have a Giorgio Armani Samsung cellular phone. If you travel to Shanghai, you will see that the latest fashion is this beautiful looking Aura cellular phone. And look at this elegant lady who has a matching bag. Actually, it's not a handbag, it's a matching laptop. Now, don't worry the man in the audience. For us also, there are nice laptops. How do you like this Ferrari laptop? Oh, you don't like Ferrari? Don't worry. Here you can have Lamborghini laptop. And please, next time you buy a helicopter for the university, make sure to get the Versace version. When I used to work at the World Bank, they would give us a laptop for our work, but they would be very boring looking laptop. So even this company had to change. And even though I will not tell you their name because I'm not here to make publicity for private firms, look, they're hiring graphic designer to make products that are more attractive so that they can compete with another brand whose name I'm not going to mention either. Well, since Steve Jobs died, perhaps we can give him a homage because he said something that I find very instructive. He said, it's not only about technology. To make successful products, we have to marry technology and humanities, technology and the arts. Only then will we be able to produce the beautiful product that make our hearts sing. So if creativity is important, how do we incorporate creativity in the training of students? Creativity is about inventing. We have to give the opportunities to our students to invent new things, new services, new products, to experiment, to think out of the box. Oh, I didn't know it was allowed in my university. To take chances, to break the rules as part of the pedagogical process, to make mistakes, and to learn from your mistakes, and most importantly, perhaps, to have fun. Now, I know this is what you are trying to do now with the transformation of your pedagogical approaches about at the university here, but believe me, I have visited so many universities where it is still very traditional teaching. The professor knows it all, and the students have to sit passively, learning from the professor, not allowed to challenge the professor. Now, if we have to recognize that if it is true that knowledge is changing so fast, we cannot expect our students to graduate with all the knowledge they need for their professional life. We need to prepare them for lifelong learning. I ask you, if you have children, would you like to take your sick child to a doctor who would tell you proudly, I graduated 30 years ago and I have not learned anything new since I graduated? Of course not. We need to update our knowledge continuously, starting very young and continuing for the rest of our life. Here is a 93-year-old Australian doctor who is getting a second PhD. And since I don't want to be accused of gender discrimination, I have to insist that lifelong learning is for both men and women. Let me introduce to you this lady from Peru. She is 106 years old and she just learned to read and write because she wants to be able to write letters to her great-grandchildren. So if we are going to be in a lifelong learning mode, we have to be humble and accept that not only do we want to learn all the time, but we also have to unlearn continuously those skills and knowledge pieces that are obsolete, that are not relevant anymore. Edwin Land, who invented the Polaroid, tells us something very important. He said, "It is not that we need new ideas. We need to stop having old ideas. Let's forget about the old ideas." Now, let me ask you something. Look at what Alvin Toffler, who is a specialist of the future, told us. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn and learn and relearn. Does anybody recognize this piece of equipment, especially those from the physics or chemistry department? Who used this slide rule when they were students? Now, I ask the young people in the audience, do you know what this is? No idea, right? You have to go to the museum. Huh? And yet, when we were students of physics, this was our main calculator, right? The slide rule. But it's a piece of the past. And to illustrate with you today this change in the pedagogical paradigm, let me tell you a story from the life of Professor Einstein, who used to travel all over the world to give lectures. And one evening, sitting in the back of his chauffeur-driven limousine, he let go a big sigh. So the driver looks in the mirror and asks him, "What's wrong, Professor?" "Oh, I'm so tired of giving these lectures." "But Professor, it's so easy for you." "What do you mean easy? When you always give the same lecture." "Okay, it is true, but it is about a very sophisticated theory." The driver says, "Yeah, but you're always telling them the same stuff." So Einstein gets a little bit annoyed. "Yes, it is true, but not anybody can give a lecture about the theory of relativity." The driver says, "Professor, with all due respect, I have listened to your lecture so many times. I believe I could give your lecture." "Aha, you believe so? Okay, I'm gonna challenge you." So they get to the university and Professor Einstein sits in the back and the driver comes to the front. And you know why? What? He must have had good memory because he starts to explain the theory of relativity so well that at the end the audience is applauding him very enthusiastically. And you can imagine Einstein in the back is very upset. And then the moderator says, "Okay, thank you very much, Professor. Can we ask you questions?" So Einstein says, "Haha, now what are you going to do?" But the driver said, "Sure, please go ahead, ask questions." And you know what? People always ask the same questions. So the driver is able to answer the questions without any difficulty. Einstein in the back is much more upset. And then the moderator said, "Okay, one last question." And then a gentleman in the middle of the audience gets up a little bit aggressive. And he says, "Professor Einstein, thank you very much for this great conference. But you know what? Until now, you have told us only about your past work. Could you please tell us what is the next step in your scientific investigation?" Now, for the first time, Einstein in the back is smiling. "Haha, what are you going to do?" But the driver doesn't stop. He looks at the gentleman and says, "Sir, thank you very much for this question. And I don't mean to be insolent, but I must tell you, in my long career as a professor, I have heard many dumb questions from my students. And I must tell you, this question you just asked me is so stupid that I'm going to ask my driver in the back to answer it." Now, if you think that this is a real picture, you definitely believe in science fiction stories. So, what is the new pedagogical approach? Today, we are in a privileged position where, instead, as a professor, instead of focusing on what I like to teach, I must focus on the needs of my students, of the learner. Furthermore, to teach today, I cannot rely anymore on what is in the textbook, because the textbook is from yesterday. I can rely on a variety of learning approaches to make the learning process active, interactive, collaborative, and experiential, directly related to real life. I have visited so many universities when in engineering, it's only in the fifth year of studies that the student starts to learn to do something. No, you have to learn from day one. Or in medical studies, only in the fourth year that the student will meet a patient for the first time. And we have to accept that the student will not only learn from the professor, but also on her or his own, and also from his or her peers, from the other students. I used to live in Washington, D.C., and the University of Maryland next door is a public university with 150,000 online students. And this is an advertisement that they use. "Welcome to class. Sit anywhere. If you have good internet connection, you can study when you want, where you want. Today, there is no more distance, whether I'm talking about geographical distance or time distance between the student and studying." Does anybody know a website called Second Life? It's a virtual website. And this is the virtual classroom of one of the top business schools in the world. It's called INSEAD. They have two campuses, one in France, one in Singapore. And through this virtual classroom, the students who are 10,000 kilometers apart, with the time difference of 6 hours, they meet in the virtual classroom and they can study together. No more distance. And this is not virtual anymore, this is real. This is the technology-enhanced active learning classroom at MIT. And in this physics class, the professor does not teach anymore. The student is what they call an inverted, flipped classroom. The students learn on their own. And the evening before coming to a session, they have to go online and take an exam to demonstrate that they have learned on their own. And when they come to the session, they will be put into groups and they will be asked by the professor to resolve a concrete problem. And in that way, the professor can verify whether the students have understood the classroom or not. And what the professor did at the end of the first term, the professor was happy with the outcome, but not too happy. And so he realized that something was missing. So he sent an email to each of the students and asked them, who among your classmates helps you best? Because as we know, when the students are learning, some students will learn fast and some students will not understand something. But they will ask their other students, because that way they will get help. So by getting the names of those students who understood better than the others, the professor hired them as assistants for the next class, because he realized that we can learn better from the other students, from the professor, because maybe we are ashamed or we are too shy to go to ask the professor, because the professor will think that you are stupid, right, if I ask the question. But if I ask my friend, they will not say that I'm stupid, they will help me. And so this professor realized that peer learning was very important. Now, I spoke about Korea earlier, right, about a good example. This is not a good example, no? But what about this classroom in Korea? Who is the professor? A robot. And look at the face of the students. Are they unhappy? No, they are very happy. So they asked them, how come you are happy with the robot? How come you prefer the robot as a professor to the human being? And they said, for two reasons. First, because the robot never screams at us. And second, because the robot never makes fun of us. By the way, you remember the example I gave you at the beginning of the surgery to cut the skin in the mouth? This is something that Korean parents do to their children, because they are so obsessed with learning to pronounce English very well. And even though there is no scientific evidence showing that it helps, somebody said that it helps, so they all do it, or many of them do it. This is a picture from 1895 in France. That was how they imagined education in the year 2000. Well, certainly education has changed. And I believe that there is a new model. Before, education was about transferring knowledge from the professor who knew everything to the student who knew nothing. I believe that today, the new education model is about constructing knowledge, professors and students together. Before, the student just followed the instruction. Today, you want your students to follow their passion. Before, we learned only in the classroom. Now we learn 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Before, we learned as individuals. Now we learn in teams. And I believe that this is going to change the structure and the shape of universities. If I'm not mistaken, this is University of Kazan, right? Majority of your students are undergraduate students, and then you have some graduate students in masters and doctorate. I believe that in the future, the shape of university will be of a star, where the traditional students coming straight from high school to become undergraduate students will be just one part here. And then you have graduate students. But perhaps more importantly, you will have continuing education, because we have to continuously update our knowledge. We will also have what I call career change studies, because estimates tell us that a young graduate today will have at least 10 different professions. I'm not saying working in 10 different companies. No, learning to do new things. So universities will have to help you change your career.
And then we have to remember that we're not only preparing professionals, but also we want to have good citizens. That is, the values, the ethical part of education is also very important. And we will not study only on campus, but also online or in a hybrid mode, combining both on campus and online learning. So, in conclusion, and since it's winter in Kazan, I want to share this picture of a lovely, peaceful mountain with lots of snow. But it's not as peaceful as it looks, because if you go closer, you will start hearing a rumbling which announces an avalanche. And I believe that this is what is happening in higher education today. So many changes, like an avalanche. And to think about how the future is going to disrupt our education, let me share with you some quotes from a few people who spoke about the future. The first one is from a science fiction writer from England, William Gibson. And he says, the future is already here, but it is unequally distributed. The other one is more traditional. It comes from the French philosopher Paul Valéry, who wrote many years ago, the trouble with the future today is that it is not as it used to be. But the one I prefer is from Alan Kay, who said in 1991 that the best way to predict the future is to invent it. Alan Kay invented the Macintosh Windows system that another company copied afterwards. Now, we have to not only to think about the future, but we have to remember the past. Let me share a true story. 200 years ago, in the small town called Cambridge, Massachusetts, a professor of mathematics visits a new high school. And he was so shocked by what he saw that he wrote a letter to his wife that night, and I read the letter in a book about education. In that letter he said, "Dear, you cannot imagine what I saw today. I entered this classroom and I saw something that I had never seen before. I saw a blackboard and a piece of chalk and a piece of cloth, and I asked myself, what is this for?" Now, we all know that in the next 200 years, the blackboard became the main pedagogical support that professors used. So the question before us today is whether the internet and the computer are going to create such an important revolution as the blackboard 200 years ago. Look at the new library. This is the library of a professor who just retired in the US. I like this kind of library. But I'm told that this is the library of the future. Maybe we don't like it, but I tell you, this is what our children are using. And so we have to think how we can use this to transform the pedagogical process. And we have to be careful. We cannot repeat the mistake of the inventor of the first steam engine locomotive. So when they put together the first train, what did they do? They took the old horse-drawn carriages. That is not innovative. We need to be more innovative, to have a new product, to transform education. It's not only about telling, oh, all our students have a laptop, but if I'm still teaching in the same way and they're using their laptop only to write down what I'm saying, this is not new education. Learning cannot be a spectator sport anymore. Cannot be passive. It has to be, I repeat, active, interactive, collaborative, and experiential. And I know it is challenging for all of us to live in this knowledge society. And since I come from North Africa, Morocco, let me share an anecdote from my part of the world to illustrate what is happening. In my country, we have this beautiful animal, a gazelle. I don't know if you have them in Kazan or in Tatarstan. It's a very gracious animal, but it has a terrible life. Because every morning, the gazelle wakes up thinking, today, once again, I need to run faster than the fastest lion if I don't want to be eaten up alive. Now I ask you, do you think the lion has a better life? I'm not so sure, because every morning the lion wakes up thinking, today once again, I need to run faster than the slowest gazelle if I don't want to starve by the end of the day. So what's the moral of this little story? It doesn't make a difference whether you're a gazelle or a lion. You have to run. It doesn't make a difference whether you are a small university or a large university, whether you are a poor university or a rich university. You cannot stay put. You have to run, because the other universities in Korea or in China or in Germany, they are not going to wait for you to get your act together. They're not going to step and say, oh, let's wait for the Russian university. No, you have to start and continue running. So you may challenge me and say, this is not a very pleasant world that I'm describing. The rule of the strongest, or the rule of the most patient. I know it's not an easy world we live in, but this is the only world we have, so we have to make do with it. And the great advantage of the university world is that we have a tradition of working together, of collaborating. And I was very impressed when the rector described how you are trying to work across disciplines, to work in teams, and to work with other universities in Russia or in other parts of the world. And if I may leave you with only one message today, this is my message. Do not allow other people to define your future. You have to take your future in your own hands and define where you want to go. We have to remember the wise words of the Roman philosopher Seneca, who told us more than 2,000 years ago that there is no favorable wind for those who don't know where they are going.
Здравствуйте, уважаемый профессор. Мы рады вас приветствовать на наших, скажем, на нашей встрече. Да. Я являюсь выпускником Казанского федерального университета, юридического факультета. В прошлом году, могу похвастаться, с красным дипломом я закончил университет, но, к сожалению, магистратуру у меня ума не хватило пройти. Вот. Уважаемый профессор, вот как у нас говорят в России, что не в деньгах счастье. И вот вы, наверное, знаете, что на сегодняшний день наша отчизна встретилась с экономическими трудностями. И, к сожалению, ну, государство не может поддержку оказывать такую, которую ранее мы ощущали и так далее, в развитии науки, образования. Вот, по моим данным, на сегодняшний день бюджет Гарвардского университета в этом году превышает весь бюджет на образование в России. И на ваш взгляд, вот какие стратегические основы и конкурентные преимущества вы заметили, приехав сюда, познакомившись с нашим многонациональным народом? Вот. В принципе, вот это первая часть вопроса, а вторая, это чисто, скажем так, мой личный интерес. Вот на ваш взгляд, через 10 лет какие направления в образовании, они будут актуальны и будут больше пользоваться спросом и будут давать результат для общества и для мира в целом? Спасибо большое.
Thank you for this challenging question. First of all, don't say that you're not intelligent enough to go to master degree. I'm sure after you have a few years of experience, you will have the opportunity. You have to believe in yourself and be motivated. Based on what, you know, it's time of crisis, we tend to be depressed. We're getting less money, the economy is shrinking, but in fact, history shows that time of crisis is a time of opportunity. In fact, I think it was the rector of the University of Maryland who said, we should not waste a good crisis. Because when things are going well, we tend to be complacent. Money is coming from the government, life is easy, why should I worry? So, time of crisis is a good opportunity to say, what are my strengths? And if I'm receiving less money from government, where can I find money? How can I develop? And to do that, you have, you know, look at the past of this university. You were pioneers in medical studies, in physics, in chemistry, in astronomy, and some of the inventions here led to development in other parts of the world. You can do it again, you can do it again, you can continue doing that. So, one of the challenges is, as you know, most universities now, many universities, especially in Russia, want to become higher, to get higher in the ranking. And the challenge of the ranking is that, oh, we look at who is best in the ranking, Harvard. I want to become like Harvard. And we start copying, and that's dangerous. What is important, and remember my last message, is to define where do you want Kazan Federal University to be in 10 years. You ask me to tell you where. I think you have to define and to create this new future, the strengths, and prepare the graduates who will believe in themselves, who will be able to create new companies. Think of Google, for example. A small country like Estonia has a graduate, two graduates, and then they become the company with the highest value in the world. So the future, and one of the challenges for the professors who design the curriculum is to prepare students for jobs that do not exist. 20 years ago, or 15 years ago, did we know what a webmaster is? You know what are the two professions now that are assessed as being in highest demand? Big science analysts and what they call growth hacker. People who are able to analyze big data and understand what is happening, and make projections. How many universities have courses to train in this field? Very few. At the beginning, if you allow me to share again a familiar personal example. At the beginning, I told you proudly about my son who released his first video game yesterday. He studied computer science in a top university, actually in the best Canadian university, University of Toronto. And then, like you, he went to work for one year, and then he came back to me and said, "Dad, I want to do a master in video game programming." And at that time, there was only one university in the world, in England, University of Hull. Anybody has heard of the University of Hull? No, because it's not high the ranking. And because I'm a specialist in ranking, I told my son, you don't understand. You have to go to a prestigious university, a university high in the ranking. And he answered me, "Dad, you don't understand. This University of Hull is the first one with a master in video game programming. They have close connection with Sony, PlayStation, with Nintendo, and that's what I want, where I want to go. The only question is, are you going to pay for my studies?" And because I'm a weak dad, of course I paid for his study. But indeed, because they were pioneer. Today you will find hundreds of masters in video game programming. But at that time, they were the first one. And my son has been very grateful that he could benefit from this education. So the challenge, to come back to your question, is to identify areas of growth in the industry, in the service economy, and to prepare your students. And maybe not to prepare them too narrowly, but to give them these generic competencies that would allow them to adapt to a changing market. In Israel, there is an institute of technology called Technion. And today, 42% of their graduates become entrepreneurs. They start their own company. Because the training at that university is putting emphasis on the ability of students to become innovative and entrepreneurial.
Спасибо большое. Спасибо.
My name is Nikaroshkov, I teach at Institute of Psychology and Education. I read your book, The Road to Academic Excellence, and case studies in book illustrate concern to maintain curriculum that blends strong scientific training with a deep humanistic conviction. Can you tell us about this problem? Thank you.
A few years back, I was invited to a conference in Hiroshima in Japan. And at the opening of the conference, the mayor of Hiroshima gave a speech. And as you can imagine, he spoke about what happened on August 6, 1945, when the US military dropped the first atomic bomb on the city, and it killed 140,000 Japanese people and injured many, many more. But the mayor of Hiroshima made his speech in a very clever way. He didn't say, "Oh, these bad Americans did this." He said, "If you think about it, this is the worst example in the history of mankind of how we use the results of science." And so it is very important in whatever discipline, that we train our students not only with the professional skills, but also with a strong feeling of ethics about what they are doing. Do we want to train medical doctors who will care only about making money and not about the well-being of their patients? Do we want to train lawyers who care only about making money and not about justice? If we think, for example, about the problem of corruption in many parts of the world, usually the corrupt, the biggest crooks are graduates of universities, where they learn clever things, but they didn't learn about ethics. One of the best engineering schools in the world today, according to my humble opinion, is a new engineering school in the US called Olin College of Engineering, O-L-I-N. I strongly advise you, if you're interested, to visit their website. Olin College of Engineering has a curriculum just like a triangle. Part of it is engineering, of course. It's about learning how to do things, what they call the feasibility. But then they are working very closely with a business school next door called Babson College, because they want all their engineers to be entrepreneurs. So they learn about viability. And then they put strong emphasis on values, on humanities, and they call that desirability. Because not everything that we produce may be desirable, may be good for the world. And the president of Olin College, who is a friend of mine, is an aeronautics engineer by training. And even though he's a president, he likes to give one class every year because he doesn't want to lose contact with the students. Now, what do you think he teaches every year? Aeronautics engineering? No. He teaches a class of ethics, because he wants his engineers to be responsible engineers, to make sure that what they produce is useful to society. So this is why I believe it is very important to combine science and the humanities. That's one reason. But there is another reason. Remember what I said about Apple, about design. You want to produce services or products that are also pleasing, that are attractive. Creativity doesn't come only from the hard sciences. It comes also from the artistic part in each human being. And that's why I believe that the tradition of separating hard science and social science humanities is not useful. I think that any engineer must know about the arts. And in today's modern technology world, nobody can operate only with social science. In every day, we have to deal with machines, with technology, and so we need to learn. And that's why, you know, in English they talk about STEM disciplines: science, technology, engineering, mathematics. But now increasingly we are talking about STEAM. You add an A, which has to do with the arts.
Mr. Salmin, I'm here. My name is Arad Kasyanov. You show the difference between Brazil and South Korea, saying that the education actually made the change in the development, economical development. You know that here in Russia we have nearly 100% higher education of the population. And we also have a very high percentage of PhDs working in the companies, but not necessarily in R&D centers. So my question is, do you think that we should focus as the university? We can't just stay put and wait when actually something changes. I think that we should be active. And do you think that what is the best strategy? Just to stay put and educate technological entrepreneurs and wait when they actually grow their companies in 5-10 years and come back to us for PhDs? Or do you think there is another strategy, fast track, that we could take?
Your country has faced a huge challenge because you had an economy that was driven to a large extent by the defense economy and strong links between universities, research institutes, and the defense industry. With the transition to market economy, these close leakages have been broken, and so you have to reinvent new ways of doing things. And I think, you know, and I don't know sufficiently about the way your universities operate, but you have to ask yourself a few questions. Why, you know, you are known, for example, as being brilliant mathematicians, but I'm told that so many Russian mathematicians have emigrated. And so you have to ask yourself, why, what is it that they get in other countries in terms of living conditions, in terms of studies, that they don't get here? How can the university keep the best talent? Because today it's about talent. Remember what I said about the oil? Of course, it's good to have oil, but look what's happening when the price of oil goes down. The price of talent will never go down. The future, the richness of a country, the wealth is us, the people, our brains, our capacity to invent. It was interesting to see when I visited a small museum, I was told that when this university was established 210 years ago, the first professors came from Germany or from France. And the point I'm making is that internationalization is an important dimension. And if you have many people in the diaspora overseas, one way of one part of your strategy should be to first to make sure you keep your talent, second that you can bring back talent from other parts of the world, from the Russian diaspora. And I was very pleased, for example, I told you I come from Morocco. Yesterday I was visiting a lab in the physics department, I believe, or in chemistry, was it chemistry? And I met somebody from a young scientist from Algeria, the country next door to my country, and Algeria has strong oil company, strong oil industry, so that explains why he would be interested in that. And I think multiplying these kind of collaborations can be very, very useful. And then it's all about removing the barriers for quick passage from invention in basic science to applications. Let me give you an example, because you have strong astronomy here, so maybe that will resonate. I visited a few years back the University of Arizona in Tucson, Arizona. It's a public university, and Arizona has desert, so it was very good to do astronomy. So they developed a strong astronomy department, and then one professor invented a new kind of glass to make telescopes that are more powerful. And as a result, there were some industrial applications. So I had an appointment with the head, the dean of the College of Optics. And when I arrived there, the dean was not there, and I met with the vice dean. And the vice dean apologized. He said, the dean had an emergency in his company. And I learned that out of 25 professors in the department, 12 of them had their own company. Because when they were doing their PhD, they invented something and that allowed them to create a company. But they are still working very closely with the university. So for example, they are using laser applications to tag
cells in the body of people who have cancer. And so it's at the intersection of optics, physics, chemistry, and medical sciences. Exactly the type of connections that you are trying to make with the new structure, multidisciplinary structure in your university.
Professor Rosa Valieva, Institute of Psychology and Education. Mr. Salme, I'm very much interested in education, first of all, because I'm a professor of education. And I would like to turn to your slide about the pedagogical approaches. And you meant here, and you named here creativity, interactive learning, and collaboration. And how do you think these notions coincide with online learning? Do they coincide? And the second, my question, is closely linked to the first one. Where is the place and what is the role of modern professor in this virtual classroom, if there is no classroom? We saw here your brilliant lecture. We saw you as a person, very very enthusiastic and very passionate. And how those students sitting somewhere thousands of miles away could interact with a nice professor, with a professor of a very high quality. Do you think that the role of modern professor should be only, well, a moderator or a tutor sitting somewhere very far and answering students online? Thank you.
Well, I don't know that I have the answer because this is a new phenomenon. You may have read about the MOOCs, these online courses that are reaching 100,000 students all over the world. And these courses are given by some of the best professors from Harvard, MIT, Stanford. And indeed, it may be a challenge for a traditional university because if the same course of physics or a course of artificial intelligence is available from MIT, why would I take it from the University of Rabat in my country? But personally, I agree with your concern about being too far from not only the professors, but also the other students. And I do believe that perhaps a hybrid mode is the answer, where you have some classes online and some direct interaction with your professor. Now, the interaction may not be physical because of the distance, but at least you need the interaction. And yes, I do believe that the professor of the future is not the professor who has all the knowledge and dictates that knowledge. This is an obsolete model. And frankly, personally, I remember being bored in many of my classes because listening to the professor in a passive way is not very satisfactory. A friend of mine by the name of Eric Mazur is professor at University of Harvard in physics. In fact, he's the dean of applied physics. He's a very known physicist in his own field of optical physics. He has patents, he's very famous. And he thought he was a great professor. And one day he realized that first, his students were bored, and second, they didn't understand very well his classes. So first reaction, immediate reaction is to say, it's because they are stupid, right? But Harvard students usually are not very stupid. Otherwise, they would not be at Harvard. So he had to challenge himself and to say, my students don't understand well because I'm not teaching well.
And it was a very humbling moment for him. And he reinvented his way of teaching. And he's the father of what we call now peer learning. And now a typical class for him will be to ask the students a question, and they use clickers, and immediately they will see the response on the screen, and then he will say, okay, now the two of you find out who is right, response A, response B, and the classroom dynamics will transform. Before you had the silence, he was explaining and everybody was listening, and now all of a sudden there is this energy because all the students are speaking among themselves, and then maybe one student will convince the other one that why he's wrong and explain the answer. And then he will ask, okay, now what is the result? And they will see immediately the transformation. To make a long story short, he has transformed his pedagogy into an interactive process where the students learn as much from each other as they learn from their professor. Now, using clickers is one methodology. In medical science, we can use simulations. We can use medical robots. The point is to make the learning process more exciting for the students and more related to real life application. That's why I talk about experiential. So coming back to your first question, can online learning deliver all of this? I'm not sure. We have to think how we use online learning. But sometimes it can help in ways we cannot imagine. For example, I remember in Pakistan, and I think those of you, since you are in a multi-religious society, you can relate to that. A professor was explaining to me that for a class of ethics, online learning was much better than traditional learning. Because when you are talking about difficult topics, in a conservative society, the students may be ashamed or afraid to ask questions in front of the other students. But if you are relating to the professors online, by email, for example, or through a website, you can ask questions, and then you can have an easier conversation than you would have in a normal classroom. So I think we cannot be agnostic about it. I don't agree with those who say online learning is going to replace traditional classroom interaction. But I don't agree also with just sticking to the traditional methodology. So we have to be open and to explore and to learn what works and what doesn't work. I'll give you another example. Carnegie Mellon University, which is very strong in engineering and computer science, they are the ones who developed software using artificial intelligence. So for example, this software will interact with the students, and based on what you know, the learning path will be different. So if you know more than your neighbor, you will learn in a different way. So you have interactive experience with the computer, with the software. So they were very excited. This is the future. So they tested it. They randomly assigned students to the traditional classroom and to the self-learning with the software. It was a course of statistics. And at the end of the term, 3 months later, both groups of students took the same exam. And the results were the same, on average. So they were happy, but they were disappointed because they expected that using the software would be better. But then somebody thought of organizing a different way. So the next term, they randomly assigned students to both groups again. But then the students who learned with the software, they told them, whenever you feel that you are ready to take the exam, come back to us. Don't have to wait the 3 months of the term. And what happened? After 5 weeks, many of the students were ready. So they realized that learning on your own allows you to learn faster. to learn at your own rhythm. So that's a significant improvement. I think that we are only beginning to realize what type of questions and what type of use of these new approaches. And this is just the beginning of a big, big revolution.